Hello and welcome. As we continue to focus on the difference God makes in our lives by the presence of His Holy Spirit, we begin with the hymn, Guide Me, O Thou Great Jehovah. Together in the name of Christ to offer our praise and thanksgiving, to hear and receive God's holy word, to pray for the needs of the world, and to seek the forgiveness of our sins, that by the power of the Holy Spirit we may give ourselves to the service of God. God the Father forgives us in Christ and heals us by the Holy Spirit. Let us therefore put away all anger and bitterness, all malice and slander, and confess our sins to God, our Redeemer. Lord God, we have sinned against you. We have done evil in your sight. We are sorry and repent. Have mercy on us according to your love. Wash away our wrongdoing and cleanse us from our sin. Renew a right spirit within us and restore us to the joy of your salvation through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. May the Father of all mercies cleanse us from our sins and restore us in his image to the praise and glory of his name through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Our Bible reading is brought to us by Chris Spicer.
Today's reading is taken from 2 Corinthians 12, verses 1 to 12. I must go on boasting, though there is nothing to be gained by it. I will go on to visions and revelations of the Lord. I know a man in Christ who 14 years ago was caught up to the third heaven. Whether in the body or out of the body, I do not know. God knows. And I know that this man was caught up into paradise. Whether in the body or out of the body, I do not know. God knows. And he heard things that cannot be told, which man may not utter. On behalf of this man, I will boast, but on my own behalf, I will not boast, except of my weaknesses. Though, if I should wish to boast, I would not be a fool, for I would be speaking the truth. But I refrain from it, so that no one may think more of me than he sees in me or hears from me. So to keep me from becoming conceited, because of the surpassing greatness of the revelations, a thorn was given me in the flesh, a messenger of Satan to harass me, to keep me from becoming conceited. Three times I pleaded with the Lord about this, that it should leave me. But he said to me, "My grace is sufficient for you, for my power is made perfect in weakness. Therefore, I will boast all the more gladly of my weaknesses, so that the power of Christ may rest upon me. For the sake of Christ, then, I am content with weaknesses, insults, hardships, persecutions, and calamities. For when I am weak, then I am strong. I have been a fool. You forced me to it, for I ought to have been commended by you. For I was not at all inferior to those superb apostles, even though I am nothing. The signs of a true apostle were performed among you with utmost patience, with signs and wonders and mighty works."
As we're continuing to think about the work of the Holy Spirit, we're focusing today on the Holy Spirit and the gift of healing. The story is told of a church with a very public healing ministry who followed their normal pattern of inviting anyone with a particular need to come forward to be prayed for. One man, when asked what he wanted prayer for, replied, "I need you to pray for help with my hearing." The minister put one finger of his hand on the man's ear and placed the other hand on top of the head, and then prayed and prayed, and the whole congregation joining in with much enthusiasm. After a few minutes, the minister removed his hands, stood back and asked, "How is your hearing now?" The man replied, "I don't know. My hearing is actually next Thursday in the magistrate's court." Misunderstandings aside, a church offering that kind of public ministry is almost certainly seeking to follow what we see in the book of Acts, where on many occasions the first Christian leaders, as well as bringing the gospel, were also empowered by the coming of the Holy Spirit to perform these kinds of signs and wonders. In some chapters, the individuals healed are named, along with a description of the condition that they were cured of. Several other verses in the book just say that the apostles, or Stephen, or Philip, or Paul, did many signs and wonders. Many were healed. What's more, on most occasions, these healings were a significant part of what led people to come to Christ, demonstrating that the message being proclaimed about him was from God. So it's easy to see why churches and Christians might seek a similar ministry today, for we very much believe that the same Holy Spirit is still given to believers. The Bible reading, though, adds a significant complication to the picture. Paul speaking about his experience of unanswered prayer and the explanations he gives as to why, despite his fervent requests, God's answer was still no. The subject of Paul's prayer were his own struggles, what he calls here a thorn in the flesh. It's possible that he's using that phrase to allude to his prayers for his opponents to stop bothering him. Most have seen it as a way of referring to a persistent health problem, quite a significant one, given that it's also described in strong terms as a messenger from Satan to harass me. As Paul in Galatians 4 seems to refer to an ongoing eye problem, that's one obvious possibility. But the fact that it isn't described in detail has in many ways made it easier for Christians down the generations to see what Paul writes here in this chapter as helpfully applying to whatever unresolved health problems or other kind of struggles they're battling with, seeing them as our thorn in the flesh. And the first explanation Paul gives as to why he believes that, despite his fervent prayer, the thorn remained, is his description of the way it kept him humble. In much of this second letter to the Corinthians, the way Paul writes is in many ways quite strange, because he's responding to those he sees as false apostles in the church, who claim to be bringing all the benefits that he brought as a genuine apostle, but without having to contend with any of the problems that he experienced. In response to which, Paul, somewhat reluctantly, spells out the supernatural work of God that he experienced, focusing in these verses especially on the revelations from God that have been entrusted to him, which, incidentally, the church down the ages has accepted as genuine divine revelation, which is why a significant chunk of what we see in our Holy Scriptures comprises the writings of the Apostle Paul. But he has also been spelling out his extreme struggles, including verse 7, which we're focusing on. So to keep me from becoming conceited because of the surpassing greatness of the revelations, a thorn was given me in the flesh, a messenger of Satan to harass me, to keep me from becoming conceited. Any outwardly successful person is in danger of letting it go to his or her head. In many ways, a religious leader who attracts a lot of followers, as Paul did, is at particular risk of becoming conceited. But he recognized that his thorn, whatever unresolved issue that's referring to, kept him humble. He still prayed for the thorn to be taken away. What believer wouldn't? But he tells us the reply that the Lord gave to his prayers. My grace is sufficient for you, for my power is made perfect in weakness. Or as Paul himself later explains what he learned from God's reply, when I am weak, then I am strong. A picture sometimes used to begin to reflect on what that means is to see the Christian believer as like a glove and God's Holy Spirit within us like the hand which supplies the real power. For the paradox there is that the weaker, the thinner the glove, the stronger, the more precisely the hand can work. If it's freezing cold and we need thick winter gloves to keep us warm, there's a trade-off we may have to make in that our hands and fingers aren't so much in control. I can think of freezing mornings when I've kept my regular outdoor gloves on in the car, only to quickly realize I shouldn't be really driving in these. Wear the right thinner, weaker gloves, and we can probably have adequate control of our vehicle. When a dentist or surgeon is operating on us, though, they need gloves for protection. But of course, they wear the thinnest, weakest, most sensitive gloves that are available so that their hands retain maximum control. And that's a bit of an illustration of what Paul is saying here about the way God can often work better when we are weak. A strong Christian leader, a strong church even, may be in danger of going their own way, doing what they want. They have enough strength in themselves anyway. In some cases, tragically, power can be used to abuse others. Where there are Christians with a strong emphasis on healing ministry, perhaps who others might see as having a particular gift in that area. In many ways, there are advantages when it's obvious that there are unresolved health issues in their own lives or their household, because there's less danger of giving unrealistic expectations about everybody being able to expect to be healed. One of the advantages of not being particularly skilled in a particular area of ministry is, I find, I pray more, I rely on God more. As we become more experienced and competent, in many ways that's a good thing. The bad side is if that means we can stop praying, depending more on our own strength rather than seeking the Lord's power. And actually, some of the most telling testimonies I've known are from people with huge ongoing struggles in life, yet who look to God and trust in him amidst their trials. I don't think this is the only answer we see in the scriptures as to why God doesn't heal everybody. It is an important truth to be taken on board, though. And of course, there's no way around the fact that it complicates our asking for healing. God, by his Holy Spirit, can still heal, of course. We're still, I believe, invited, encouraged to pray for ourselves and for others when there are health problems, to cast our cares on him. To my mind, those kinds of big upfront prayers for healing become very difficult, though, because they can seem to imply that healing is either guaranteed or, at the very least, can normally be expected. Why do people appear to be miraculously healed so much more often in New Testament times than they do today, even in churches which major on healing? I haven't got a complete answer to that. But Paul's description at the end of our reading of miracles as one component of the signs of an apostle may be part of the answer. In the Bible as a whole, a preponderance of miraculous healings only occurs at specific times and not on every page or in every period of the life of God's people. It might be added too that the gift of modern medicine makes it harder to use healings as cast iron proof of God and of the message we proclaim. Most of us wouldn't want to be without hospitals, but it means that those who are skeptical will often discount the believer when we say that God has healed us. Although I do think that communicating to others that we're grateful to God when we get better as a result of our prayers is no bad thing anyway. If it feels scary to give that testimony to those who don't share our faith, remember the Holy Spirit's work is also to give us boldness. And that's true whether we experience his healing or not. Some of the words that have most impact on others actually can be from people who are fairly sure that they're dying, where even if there's been a prayer for healing, it's looking increasingly unlikely that God is going to restore their health in this life anyway. But for those who are genuinely able to speak of their continuing to trust in him and their hope beyond the grave, their words can have a real impact. The Holy Spirit can be very much at work in that way too. Just one more example of how, even if at a person's weakest point, perhaps especially at their weakest, the power of God can shine through. Or in the words given by the Lord to the Apostle Paul, "My grace is sufficient for you, for my power is made perfect in weakness." Amen. We affirm our faith. Do you believe and trust in God the Father? I believe in God the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. Do you believe and trust in his Son, Jesus Christ? I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again, he ascended into heaven, he is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. Do you believe and trust in the Holy Spirit? I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Helen Swanborough is going to lead us in prayer.
In the power of the Spirit and in union with Christ, let us pray to the Father. Father God, we praise you for the wonders of your creation and for the beauty and abundance of your provision for our needs, so evident in the glory of midsummer. Thank you for your precious gift of salvation through the death and resurrection of the Lord Jesus Christ, a gift open to all who put their trust in him. Thank you for all who have sought to take that good news of Jesus to those living in the Westlands over the past 80 years, since the foundation of the church here. We pray for faith in the future, the project to build a new church and community hub presented to the church community with an invitation for funding last week. We thank you for the meticulous work of our vicar Andrew, the buildings committee and the funding committee, which has brought us to this point. We pray for wisdom and sensitivity for those preparing to visit church members to explain the project, and for a prayerful and generous response from all of us as we examine our own giving. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Gracious Father, we pray for churches here in Newcastle and across the country as we take tentative steps towards more in-person worship, and for worshippers to grow in confidence about returning to church. We particularly pray for the progress of work with children and young people, and thank you for the faithful commitment of Naomi, our children and families worker, and her dedicated helpers through such challenging times. We pray for the distribution of It's Your Move books to children moving from primary to secondary schools after the summer, especially since this last year has been so disrupted for them. We pray for the Reverend Alison Thomas, who is to be instituted as Vicar of Basford and Woolstanton next week, that she will receive a warm welcome from those congregations and from local clergy as she begins her ministry in this area. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Father God, we continue to pray for our government and their advisers. Grant them wisdom and insight to make decisions affecting the well-being and health of every sector of the population, and strength to keep going through the pandemic and the many other presenting issues. We pray for countries overwhelmed by the number of coronavirus cases and hospital admissions, particularly in South America. And here we particularly bring to you our Link Mission partners in Brazil, Jimmy and Katia Rocks, Joanna and Davi. Guide and protect them and their Vineyard Church community in Florianapolis as they make the healing power of Christ known to people struggling with the damage brought on their lives by the pandemic. Nor do we forget, Father, those countries in our news which are affected by injustice and violence, particularly Iran, Hong Kong, Belarus, Myanmar, and Ethiopia, praying for the protection of all suffering people. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Loving Father, at the height of the summer sports season, we give thanks for the enjoyment and recreation that sport gives us, both in watching the best players and participating ourselves. As we enjoy football, tennis, cricket and golf, and in a few weeks the Olympics, we pray for the opportunities for welcome, hospitality and friendship that these events provide. We pray for goodwill and fairness to prevail, and we commit to you those with responsibility to organise and to keep everyone safe and prevent the spread of infection. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Compassionate Father, we all know those amongst our families and friends who are fearful, anxious, lonely, sad, or disappointed, and we lift them to you now, together with those in this community in need of our prayers. Julie Stops and the bereaved family and friends of Jack Stewart, the brother of Mary Garner, whose funeral took place in the last week. May they find peace and comfort in your love and protection and hope in your promises. Merciful Father, accept these prayers for the sake of your Son, our Saviour, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Exhaling joy of heaven to earth come down.
the blessing. May the God of hope fill us with all joy and peace in believing through the power of the Holy Spirit. And may the blessing of God Almighty, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit be with us all and those we care for today and evermore. Amen.